Okay. Good evening and a very warm welcome to this extension of the Utopia anniversary event series from 2016, which was the year of the 500th anniversary of the publication of Thomas More's Utopia, into this new year. Clearly, the relevance of the concept of utopia is independent of any strict time frame. We decided to continue with this series into 2017 because of the broad interest these events have generated, as we can see now, and the various perspectives and discussions which showed that an engagement with the idea of utopia is highly relevant. In terms of cultural history, and in relation to present day, one may say, far from utopian realities. This is also a question today's exciting talk is going to ask. I quote from the abstract, "Does the Mediterraneanist utopia, which of course we will hear about shortly, have anything to say to us today in an increasingly cynical and xenophobic world?" Tonight's speaker, Dr. Adrian Grima, is probably well known to all of you, but it is a great pleasure to introduce him. Adrian not only teaches literature and representations of the Mediterranean in the Department of Maltese here at the university, he has also written and edited a number of academic works in Maltese, English, and Italian. I may mention that Adrian contributed a highly interesting paper to the volume on insularity, which came out last year, co-edited by Kathrin and myself. As I'm sure you know, Adrian Grima has also published prize-winning collections of poetry and short stories in Maltese. In relation to today's topic, Adrian has spoken about the Mediterranean imaginary at conferences in Malta and abroad, including a keynote speech at the University of Oxford. We are delighted to be able to host this talk tonight in collaboration with the Department of Maltese. And in fact, this marks another anniversary, the 80th anniversary to the day. So here we are back within a strict time frame of Albert Camus' speech at the inauguration of the Maison de la Culture in Algiers in 1937. Thanks so much, Adrian, for thinking of this exciting topic. I'm looking forward to your paper.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Kathrin, and to all the people involved in the Utopia series. This talk is being held on the 80th anniversary, as Kathrin was saying, to the day of a lecture on native culture, the new Mediterranean culture in Algiers, given by Albert Camus. But only a few days ago, we heard about the passing away on the 2nd of February, at the age of 84, of a leading contemporary Mediterraneanist, the Bosnian Croat writer and scholar Predrag Matvejevic. Professor Matvejevic taught at major universities in Zagreb, Paris, and Rome, and is best known for his 1987 non-fiction book written in Serbo-Croat, translated to English as Mediterranean, a Cultural Landscape, a seminal work of cultural history of the Mediterranean region, which has been translated into more than 20 languages. In 2001, he was interviewed by students of the Liceo Classico Umberto I of Napoli. One of the questions referred specifically to the 1937 lecture by Camus on the new Mediterranean culture. To Camus' idea that the origins of Mediterranean culture lie not in Latinity, in the Roman Empire, as the staunch French colonialists argued, but in Greek culture, and that the Mediterranean is not classical and ordered, but, to quote from Camus, but diffuse and turbulent. Like the, again to quote, the Arab districts and the ports of Genoa and Tunisia. Matvejevic immediately makes the point that Camus was born on the shores of the Mediterranean in Algeria, and he was fascinated by the Mediterranean. To quote Matvejevic, he was a true Mediterranean, whatever that may mean. His best writings are connected, again I'm quoting from Matvejevic, his best writings are connected to the Mediterranean myths, to Greece. He is effectively more connected with to Greece than Rome. This is the Mediterranean he thought of, one that is imbued, the word in Italian he uses is penetrato, by the East. Many beliefs came from the East. Fruits like oranges, lemons, peaches, and apricots came from elsewhere. Most plants, says Matvejevic, came from the East. Camus talks about the inspiration that came from the East. Greece assimilated these great traditions and transmitted them to Rome. Il Mediterraneo, says Matveyevich, è proprio come un insieme, pur essendo spaccato, pur essendo lacerato. C'è qualche cosa che collega queste nostre sponde. E queste sintesi mediterranee si trovano in qualche modo in questa idea di Camus. Si trovano nei migliori poeti greci e italiani. Despite being fractured, despite being lacerated, the Mediterranean is a whole, a unity. There is something that connects our shores, says Matveyevich. And these, plural, Mediterranean syntheses, a word, an expression which Laurent Rapin will use in his articles in Melita in 1937-38, at the same time that Camus made his speech, are somehow present in Camus' idea. In the best Greek and Italian poets, writes Matveyevich. Matveyevich offers a subjective perspective on the history of the Mediterranean, arguing that it cannot be reduced to prescribed categories. In her review of his famous book, this is Matveyevich, and this is, well, the version that Oliver Frigeri had given me when I was writing my first thesis. This is his book, translated into Italian. In her review of this book, Céline Dover argues that the task he sets himself is one of poetically evoking rather than tightly representing the Mediterranean. More than a defined place on the map, the Mediterranean becomes a cultural and intellectual product. It is a sea of promiscuity, writes the reviewer, where the ideas, religions, traditions, and languages have shaped history. The author describes the Mediterranean as the basis for history and culture, and his philosophy of the sea tries to encompass everything. Matveyevich's concern is less with political occurrences than with the marking influences of climate, religion, food, and intercultural relations. He offers a systemic approach proposing to retrace the Mediterranean as a place of promiscuity and commonalities, linked by the sea. One of the ways he uses to retrace the history of interaction, writes Dover, is through linguistics, perennially referring to the Greek tradition so as to provide evident linkages between the numerous Mediterranean actors. This book is written with a passion which is not dissimilar to that of Brodel or Camus. And it is the passion, the poetry, the personal conviction, I would say, that keeps it all together, this now classical book. This talk deals with utopian narratives of Mediterranean unity, with a focus on Gabriel Odizio of the École d'Alger, and the pied noir of Godsetan origin, Laurent Rapin. The Saint-Simonians are credited with having been the first to float the idea of the Mediterranean as a shared political, economic, and cultural space. And Michel Chevalier's articles, which first appeared in January 1832 in the, I'll show you, this is a recent edition of Michel Chevalier's collection of four articles, and the rail and the train on the front cover, you know, is a quite significant image we'll come back to. Because this is an idea which comes up in the Utopia, which Saint-Simon wrote about at the beginning of the 19th century in 1804. The Saint-Simonians are credited with having been the first to float the idea of the Mediterranean as a shared political, economic, and cultural space. And Michel Chevalier's articles, which first appeared in January and February of 1832, this is practically 100 years before the speech, the lecture by Camus, in the Saint-Simonians paper Le Globe, give a good idea of the kind of Mediterranean system, système de la Méditerranée, they imagined. This vision is inspired by the utopia set out by Claude-Henri Saint-Simon in writings like his Letters from an Inhabitant of Geneva to His Contemporaries of 1803, actually, which Paul Ricoeur discusses in his lectures on ideology and utopia, which I think forms the sort of the heart of the talk I'm giving today. In my talk, I would like to explore how the Mediterraneanist utopian vision of writers like Odizio, inspired by the utopia of the Saint Simonians, becomes what Odizio calls the oxygen of the future, and whether this has anything to say about the Mediterranean imaginary in the literature of the late 20th and early 21st century. So I'll move on now directly to the lecture itself. I was considering sort of showing literally all the lecture in a series of slides, but it would take quite long, even though it's a relatively short lecture. Camus was 24 when he gave this lecture. This is 1937, and it is a community arts center, as Neil Foxley kind of interprets this Maison de la Culture, this House of Culture, which was basically a project of the Front Populaire, which is a communist party organization in Algiers, which of course at the time was literally part of France, unlike Tunisia and Morocco. Camus' lecture is divided into six parts. In the introduction, he declares that the House of Culture, which is being introduced, aims to serve Mediterranean culture. In the second part, he presents what he calls obvious facts about the Mediterranean region. And he gives two sort of main areas, main obvious facts. There is a Mediterranean Sea, a basin, he says, that links many countries and that all peoples of the Mediterranean are members of the same family. Now, one would obviously have to say that this is very much Eurocentric and very much a colonialist idea, which does not mean that it is a negative project in the sense that it is a project in which Camus or Odizio or other people in their Col d'Alger did not have, you know, lofty ideals. But this is a project, this is an idea, of the Mediterranean Sea as one family, which is basically deep in colonial soil. There are also other historical, obvious historical facts, he says, like the one that every time that a doctrine has entered the Mediterranean basin, in the resulting collision of ideas, it is always the Mediterranean that has remained intact, says Camus, the region that has defeated the doctrine. In the third part of his lecture, he literally numbers these different parts. Camus points out that this living reality, that is the Mediterranean, is not something new for us. It has its origins in antiquity, not in Latinity, in Rome and the Romans, but in the essential genius of Greece, the prettiness and affectation of its lost centuries. Now, this argument about how the Mediterranean culture does not have its origins in Rome, but in Greek culture, is a very important argument, a central argument in the works of Gabriel Odizio, who is in a way the spiritual father of the early Albert Camus, who had just published in 35 and 36 two books, twins. The second book has the same main title and a secondary different title. The first one is Genèse de la Méditerranée, and the second is Genèse de la Méditerranée, Sel de la Mer, Salt of the Sea, in which Odizio attacks the idea that the Mediterranean has its roots in basically in Roman imperialism and in Roman culture and in what they see as a military culture or a militaristic culture. In the fourth part of his lecture, Camus describes the Mediterranean as an international basin crossed by every current of all regions. The Mediterranean is perhaps the only one to link up with the great Eastern philosophies. For it is not classical and ordered, it is diffuse and turbulent, like those Arab quarters or those ports of Genoa and Tunisia, which we mentioned before. This culture, this Mediterranean truth, exists and manifests itself in every way, says Camus. And he gives two main ways in which this culture manifests itself. Linguistic unity, the fact that, and notice the example he gives, that the Romance languages are very similar to each other. This is the linguistic unity that he is talking about. Again, inevitably very Eurocentric, very French perspective. And the second, unity of origins. Prodigious collectivism of the Middle Ages, he says, order of knights, monastic order, feudal systems, etc. In the fifth part of his lecture, Camus writes about how the Mediterranean region must transform the doctrines of today. The battle for collectivism is not played out in Russia, because, of course, the Front Populaire and the communists were attacked, that they were basically repeating what was repeating all the mistakes done by the Russian communists. So he wants to make it very clear that this is not the same kind of project. It is being, the battle for collectivism, he says, is being played out in the Mediterranean basin and in Spain at the present time. Of course, this is the moment of the Spanish Civil War, which he refers to more than once. The task of the Maison de la Culture is to rehabilitate the Mediterranean, to take it back from those who unjustly lay claim to it, to make it ready to receive the economic forms that await it, to discover what is concrete and alive in it, and to encourage the diverse aspects of this culture. In the sixth and last part of the lecture, Camus talks about the difficult role of the intellectual. It is not for him to change history, says Camus. Whatever people may say, revolutions are made first and ideas come afterwards. Scorn and disapproval is attached to the name intellectual, because very often the intellectual is seen as an egocentric, argumentative, and abstract gentleman who is incapable of connecting with life. The intellectual must restore to culture its true face of health and sunlight. His task is to act on the man who himself makes history, I'm quoting, to reconnect culture with life. So if anything, the intellectual needs to influence the people who actually make history, because the intellectual is not in a position to make history themselves. The Mediterranean, which surrounds us with smiles, sunlight, and sea, teaches us a lesson in this respect. Intellectuals must not separate themselves from the world. There is only one culture, the culture that lives in hills, trees, and men. In the world of violence and death that surrounds us, there is no place for hope. But there is perhaps a place for civilization, the true civilization, the one that puts truth before fables, life before dreams. This is... I was actually thinking of going into detail in each of the six parts, but I think the eight pages I've prepared for this defy the rules of time. So I hope this works, but I'd like to do something else in this context. No. Okay. I'll solve this just a second. Okay. That should work. Okay, so let me explain very quickly. This is catepiacin. Catepiacin is sort of the most important North African Francophone writer of the 20th century. His work, well, the first most important. And his work, Nejma, was considered to be a groundbreaking work, both in terms of themes and in terms of style. So I'll try to, yes, seems to work. Okay. And what is it's going to be a bit complicated to follow the English because it conflicts with the words at the back. But basically, he was asked about Albert Camus, and his argument is going to be that Camus should never be seen as an Algerian writer. And I'm presenting this short, and then he compares him to William Faulkner. He says William Faulkner was also racist, but at least he knew the language. He spoke, he interacted with the blacks in the United States, while Camus was completely removed from the life of the Arabs. And all you have to do is to look at his, you know, major, one of his major works, which is L'Étranger, and see how the Arabs are basically ignored. He's going to use this word, they are ignored, are left out of the text. So this sounds like something which has little to do with Camus' idea of the Mediterranean, but actually it does. Because Camus is talking, he talks very beautifully, very poetically about life in Algiers and on the southern shores of the Mediterranean, and how North Africa had become sort of the ideal Mediterranean culture, where the Europeans were present, where the Arabs were present. But in reality, these were very separate groups. And Odizio, in a work he wrote in the 50s, admitted as much, sort of looking back at what he himself and the others had written, sort of he admits that in reality, this ideal Mediterranean civilization that was being created on the shores of the Mediterranean was not quite what they were saying it was. So, I promise not to interrupt again.
Avant l'indépendance, et même aujourd'hui, il y a des gens qui prétendent que c'est Albert Camus. Et il est vrai que pendant longtemps, Albert Camus a représenté ce qu'on a appelé l'école d'Alger. Et c'était un homme de gauche. Simplement, les Français qui connaissent Camus, peut-être le connaîtraient mieux, le comprendraient mieux, s'il le comparait à un autre écrivain qui s'est trouvé dans la même situation, un écrivain américain, un grand écrivain, un autre prix Nobel comme Camus, c'est William Faulkner. Voilà, là nous avons deux écrivains qui naissent dans des conditions à peu près semblables. Et on peut dire que Camus était d'origine plus modeste même. Enfin, Faulkner était un fils de colon dans le sud des États-Unis. Il était dans la même position à peu près, dans la même situation fausse, c'est-à-dire il vivait parmi les Algériens.
I'm breaking my promise, sorry. But with my elementary French, I think I noticed that he says that they both found themselves in a false situation. And this is not translated in the English version. Une situation fausse, he says. And this is, he's talking about a false situation. Of course, a situation, a colonial situation, which is not given any account of in the speech by Camus.
Faulkner vivait parmi les Noirs du sud des États-Unis. La grande différence, c'est que Faulkner parler la langue des Noirs. Il emploie même dans ses livres l'argot des Noirs des États-Unis. Il les connaissait. Il était resté raciste, il avait des relents racistes. Mais dans ses livres, il se débattait avec ses nègres, avec ses Noirs. Il essayait de les comprendre, et il les comprenait souvent. Et ça ne l'empêchait pas de les haïr. Par contre, chez Camus, d'un côté, il était pour nous, pas pour l'indépendance, mais enfin, pour les indigènes, pour être moins brutal, moins raciste. Mais c'était au fond une position morale, seulement morale. Parce que dans l'œuvre de Camus, on peut voir facilement que les plus belles pages de Camus, c'est quoi? C'est Tipaza, c'est la plage, c'est le paysage, l'Algérie est belle, mais il n'y a pas de peuple, on ne voit pas le peuple algérien. Dans les livres de Camus, le peuple algérien est pratiquement inexistant. C'est très révélateur. Si on prend deux livres, l'un de Camus et l'un de Faulkner, on peut prendre par exemple L'étranger de Camus et Lumière d'août de Faulkner, qui peuvent très bien être comparés ici. Dans L'étranger, le personnage algérien, le seul, je crois qu'il s'appelle Saïd, c'est à peine s'il existe. On le voit tout juste, je ne sais même pas s'il dit quelques mots, et hop, il meurt d'un coup de soleil, plus de Saïd, plus d'Algérien, et tout le reste, c'est l'Algérie française, c'est pas l'Algérie. Par contre, dans Lumière d'août, Faulkner trace le portrait d'un nègre assassin qu'il charge avec haine, même en sang, qu'il se bat avec ce nègre dans son livre. Mais ce nègre-là domine le livre. Et là, on sent vraiment un travail d'écrivain, un grand écrivain, parce qu'il savait de quoi il parlait. Et le grand malentendu, c'est ça, justement, ici en Algérie. Il était impossible, surtout aux écrivains, il y a peut-être eu des exceptions, mais dans l'ensemble, ça reposait avant tout sur une illusion, un malentendu, une situation fausse, puisque Camus vivait toujours parmi les Européens. Il n'avait aucune ouverture, et je dirais même, on pourrait l'accuser, mais il ne faut pas non plus tomber dans une autre position morale. En fait, il n'y avait pas la curiosité la plus élémentaire pour la vie de ce peuple, pour sa langue. C'était sa vision du peuple algérien était une vision très rudimentaire, très lointaine. Et par là même, ça a infirmé son œuvre. Et on l'a vu d'ailleurs très curieusement pendant la guerre d'Algérie. Alors pendant la guerre d'Algérie, il a eu une position morale assez courageuse, puisque les pieds noirs lui ont jeté des tomates, il voulait même les tuer. Bon, c'est vrai. Mais d'un autre côté, à un moment donné, lorsqu'il a eu le prix Nobel, il a eu une parole révélatrice. Et à un moment donné, juste après la remise du prix, il y a eu une conférence, il y avait des journalistes. On lui a posé la question, parce que sa mère était encore ici. Sa mère était encore en Algérie pendant la guerre. Et il en est arrivé à dire, moi, si je dois choisir entre l'Algérie et ma mère, je choisis ma mère. Et à ce moment-là, dans la salle, il y a justement un nommé Saïd, comme le personnage qu'il a tué dans son roman. C'est très curieux. C'est un travailleur algérien qui travaillait là-bas, en Suède. Il se trouvait dans le public. Et qui lui a dit, moi je ne ferai pas la différence entre l'Algérie et ma mère. C'est-à-dire, quand on se sent algérien, on ne viendrait pas à l'idée, il ne pourrait pas venir à l'idée d'un Algérien de dissocier sa mère de l'Algérie. Voilà, le drame, il est là. C'est pourquoi, bon, il faut quand même que les Français comprennent une fois pour toutes que la littérature algérienne, ce n'est pas Camus, et l'Algérie n'est pas française. Et par là, la littérature est un bon moyen to comprehend.
Could I just say one thing at this point? Because he mentions somebody who interrupted Albert Camus during the speech that he gave that is one of the speeches. And this person, now it is a well-known fact because he has been interviewed several times years later. He said that he had been paid, actually, to interrupt Camus and remind him of the fact that he has made his choice about not forgetting his mother, but taking a position in favor of another vision of how Algeria could help in establishing peace in the Mediterranean, etc. The Kateb Yassin is one of those people who actually was given a French education, but had a crisis in his life and stopped writing in French and turned to Arabic. So I'm not saying that he mentions this particular person on purpose to blacken Albert Camus, but I'm just saying that now we know for a fact that the person asked to interrupt Camus was paid to do it.
My main argument, so, because I thought a lot about this when preparing for the lecture. I did not have the intention to do a lecture, to give a lecture about Albert Camus, but more to move on from that and to think about representations of the Mediterranean and how these representations affect us today. Because I find that many people, even today, are unaware or choose to be unaware of the profoundly colonial roots of certain discourse about Mediterranean culture. Which, of course, does not mean that we cannot, and people have not in the past, reappropriate these lofty ideals, these great ideals, because whose motives are always, you know, crystal clear and you know, completely clean. We all have our different motives, and there are also always many reasons why we create our utopias. But as Ricoeur will say, and this is sort of the heart of my lecture, we need utopias. And we need utopias not because we need dreams, but because utopias allow us to challenge the present, which is dubious, which is faulty. So utopia has been viewed as a mere dream, a wishful fancy. But actually, Ricoeur says in his lectures on ideology and utopia, which is a fantastic book, which I'll just refer to briefly, the best function of utopia is actually the exploration of the possible. The utopia puts in question what presently exists. It is an imaginative variation on the nature of family, of power, religion, and so on. We are forced to experience the contingency of the social order. Utopia is not only a dream, though, for it is a dream that wants to be realized, says Paul Ricoeur. The intention of utopia, actually, he uses the translation uses the definite article all the time. The utopia is not only a dream, though, for it is a dream that wants to be realized. The intention of the utopia is to change. And if I see anything in this 80-year-old speech by Camus, I see this will, despite all the faults, despite the different contexts which need to be investigated and which Neil Foxley investigates, I think, admirably in his analysis of this speech. We need to investigate those contexts, but we also need to keep the dream alive, because the dream is actually a way of challenging that which we do not like in the world in which we live. And not challenging it, you know, in some kind of cloudy way, but in a very concrete way. Because the moment you create an alternative, you imagine an alternative to what exists in the present, you are challenging, you are undermining that which is unjust, for example. And there's a lot of injustice in the Mediterranean, of course, of today. So the intention of the utopia is to change, to shatter the present order, says Ricoeur. Utopia is the constant ideal, toward which we are directed, but which we never fully attain. Ricoeur talks about how the death of utopia would be the death of society. A society without utopia would be dead, because it would no longer have any project, any prospective goals. And this reminds me, of course, of Odysseus' idea of utopia, of this Mediterranean culture that he, Camus, and others, and the Ecole d'Algérie imagined, this idea of a culture which is the oxygen of the future. Utopia attempts to confront the problem of power itself. It may offer either an alternative to power or an alternative kind of power. Ricoeur is particularly interested in the way utopias, even the most rationalistic, attempt to reintroduce the emotional impulse. The problem is how to impassion it, society, to move it and to motivate it. At times, the answer is to call into prominence, as does Saint-Simon, the role of the artistic imagination, because Saint-Simon, in his utopia, which does not refer directly to the Mediterranean, his followers will refer to the Mediterranean. His followers will create sort of an ideal, a very, you know, practical and concrete image of a future Mediterranean. But Saint-Simon himself does not refer to the Mediterranean. At times, the answer is to call into prominence, as does Saint-Simon, the role of the artistic imagination. And Saint-Simon gives a leading role function to artists, as he does to chemists, physicists, and other scientists. Another response is to call upon the political educator. This role is that of intellectual midwifery, says Ricoeur. It is the role of the creative mind who begins a chain reaction in society. Saint-Simon, for example, thought that he himself played this part of political educator. Another way to raise this problematic of motivation is to see how utopias appropriate the language and claims of religion. On the basis of his discussions of Saint-Simon, Ricoeur raises the question whether all utopias are not in some sense secularized religions that are also always supported by the claim that they found a new religion. And then Ricoeur goes into, you know, a detailed analysis of Saint-Simon, which I don't have time to go into. But allow me to say that Saint-Simon's last publication, which came out actually in the year in which he died, 1825, was called Nouveau Christianisme, the New Christianity, because he moved Saint-Simonianism towards this idea of having a movement which is actually a new religion. It became what they called a new Christianity, a new religion. So this brings me to Michel Chevalier, 1832. Of course, he... that's my mobile. In this book, Michel Chevalier, who was basically an engineer and an entrepreneur, came up with a number of ideas of how the Mediterranean would become a system. And the basis of this system was a network of rails, of railways. In a series of articles that first appeared in the newspaper Le Globe between 20 January and 12 February 1832, which at the time was subtitled, this organ, the official organ of the Saint-Simonians, was called Le Globe, and the subtitle was Journal de la Religion Saint-Simonienne, and were then collected in this book, published in March 1832. Michel sees the Mediterranean becoming, and this is the metaphor that is used and which is generally picked up by Odizio and by Camus, the wedding bed, the Mediterranean becoming the wedding bed of the East and West. In another article in which he maps out his Mediterranean system, Chevalier writes about how how we can now consider the Mediterranean as a series of large gulfs, each of which is an entry point to a large Mediterranean, to a large country bordering the sea. He writes about the new era that is opening up for the people of the Mediterranean and points out that Italy, whose shape suggests that it is Europe's messenger reaching out to Africa and Asia, will have a special mission to carry out because it has the soul of an artist and is voluptuous and cheerful like a girl from the East. In another passage from his essay on the Mediterranean system, subtitled Russia, because his Mediterranean extends all the way north to Russia, Chevalier points out that some Mediterranean nations have passive populations whose docile and submissive attitude leads effortlessly to servility. In order to make progress, they need to be initiated above all in, he says, into French vivacity, Italian mobility, and Breton dexterity. Again, the Eurocentrism of these ideals. In order to motivate the Slav races, the country people of Austria, Hungary and Bohemia, and the Muscovite nation, his project proposes to excite them with examples of extraordinary movement, with le spectacle d'une prodigieuse vélocité, and to encourage them to enjoy the benefits of industrial progress, especially in terms of rail connections, which will have a decisive influence on a large part of the world, and especially Russia. Chevalier anticipates that thousands of steamships will sail the Mediterranean in all directions, from the Black Sea, the Baltic, the Caspian, and the Persian Gulf, all the way to Gibraltar. He anticipates that all agriculture on the Mediterranean territory will flourish both through the construction of irrigation canals and the draining of marshland, that the mineral resources of this territory will be exploited by following a holistic plan, and that factories of all kinds will be built to produce all kinds of products for the well-being of humankind. Towards the end of his most important essay regarding the Mediterranean, Chevalier points towards the establishment of what he calls a Mediterranean Confederation, based on peace rather than war, that would allow for immense industrial development. Because in the Saint-Simonian project of people like Michel Chevalier, industrial progress, industrial development is what is going to take the place of war. Because the emphasis is on industrialization, this will, you know, keep people away from war. I only have about 10 minutes left, so I'll move on to Laurent Ropin and explain why. So what's the connection between Albert Camus' talk and Laurent Ropin's articles in Melita? So I'll explain the connections over here, but at one point in an article, which I'm not going to be referring to directly, but which I will mention now in my short introduction to Laurent Ropin's work, in an article he published in Melita, which was basically a periodical, which was published by the Maltese community in North Africa, specifically in Sousse in Tunisia, but which in a way sort of brought together the different voices of the Maltese diaspora in North Africa, but also in Egypt, because they had very good contacts with people like Ivo Muscatat Zopardi and others, Tony Said in Egypt, etc. In one of his articles, he gets permission from Gabriel Odizio to reproduce an article which Odizio had written about Camus' speech at the inauguration of the Maison de la Culture. So basically, Laurent Ropin, this Godsetan who left at the age of two with his family to go to Algeria to basically work on farms, and then got a French education, joined the French army, fought in the First World War, married a French nurse, and moved to France. He had been in France, by this time he had been in France for 20 years. So this is not Laurent Ropas, still living in Algeria, but he had already been there for a long time in France. But basically, he was very much in touch with what was happening in the École d'Alger. He was in constantly with Robert Randau. They sent many letters to each other. He was corresponding with people in Malta. But this is well known to those of us who are interested in militancia. Perhaps what is less known among people who work on Laurent Ropas, let's say from the Maltese side, is his very good contacts, not only in the literary world, but also the French literary world, but also in this area of Mediterraneanist ideals. So under the direct influence of Gabriel Odizio and Robert Randau, who were central figures in the École d'Alger of the 1930s, Laurent Ropas, who had by then been in France for 20 years, writes about Mediterranean humanism, which he equates with Maltese humanism, distinguishing it clearly from Latin humanism, of course, as Odizio had done in his books and as Camus did in his speech. The soul of the Maltese, their language and their race, represent the most complete synthesis of the Mediterranean humanism that Odizio writes about in his hugely influential books at the time, both published by Gallimard, Jeunesse de la Méditerranée, 1935, and its sequel, Celle de la Mer, 1936, and which he would take up again in a third book called Ulysse ou l'Intelligence, a very unusual title, Ulysses or Intelligence, published in 1946. Maltese Mediterranean humanism, writes Ropas, is both broader and richer than Latinity. This position inevitably distanced him from the nationalism of the pro-Italian conservatives of the Nationalist Party here in Malta, who saw the Maltese as culturally Latin. The largest Maltese emigrant communities in the 19th and early 20th century were in Egypt, Algeria, and Tunisia. When Laurent Ropas, 1861-1967, when his family from Gozo settled in the village of Alelik near the city of Bonn, what is today called Annaba, in the early 1890s, there were about 15,000 Maltese emigrants in Algeria and thousands more in Tunisia. By the end of the 19th century, Algeria had the largest Maltese migrant community in the Mediterranean. When war broke out in 1914, as a French subject, Ropas was called up for military service and was decorated. When war ended in 1918, rather than return to Algeria, he went to France and died there in 1967 at the age of 76. Despite the lyrical and almost mystical love he professed for his country of origin, Malta Gozo, and unlike Jacqueline, his alter ego in his second novel, Kalin, Ropas never returned to the Maltese Islands. He never returned to Algeria after having settled in France either. In 1932, he published a largely autobiographical first novel called Le Chant de la Noria, L'Agna Tassigna, translated by José Aquilina, The Song of the Watermill. By 1891, there were 1,500 Maltese settlers in Bonn, the largest European community there. In Algeria, the Maltese were the third largest group after the French and the Italians. Ropas wrote passionately from France about the duty of the Maltese emigres to preserve the language of their ancestors, an important theme in Kalin. In an article in Melita, published in September 37, Ropas described himself as an internationalist, as, of course, Camus does in his speech, who was born in a country he hasn't visited and doesn't know, was brought up in a second, and spent his adulthood in a third country, France, where he now feels as if it has always been his country, he says. In an article published in Melita in March 38, Malto's Amitié Méditerranéenne, Ropa pits what some French colonialists like Morat, who blamed the decline of Greece on Asiatic and Semitic contamination, saw as their empire's restoration of the Roman Empire against a movement of ideas born in Nice some years before called Les Amitiés Méditerranéens. This he saw, Ropa saw this as truly Mediterranean and was therefore liberating. The multifaceted Mediterranean includes the Romans. This is Ropa writing. The multifaceted Mediterranean includes the Romans, the Egyptians, the Mesopotamians, the Phoenicians, the Greeks, and the Jews. The Mediterranean civilization is made up of all these rays. Ropa states that he prefers the objectives of this movement that unites the Greco-Latin, the Christian, Jew, and Islamic elites, and the reconciliation of peoples to the reconstitution of the Roman Empire. Because the staunch French colonialist, the so-called Algerianist, had a different idea and proposed Latinity as the origin of the Mediterranean culture. The argument against the limits of so-called Latin humanism is partly based on the fact that a reading of Mediterranean and Maltese culture must take into account the rich Muslim dimension. This is probably why Laurent Ropa, once again inspired by Odizio, encourages his Maltese compatriots to put aside any preconceived ideas when studying whether the Maltese were Islamized when Malta was under the Arabs. The fact that the majority of the Maltese are loath to accept that their ancestors might have become followers of Muhammad, writes Ropa, does not itself prove anything. Odizio writes, with more than a hint of ironic diplomacy, Odizio, that he would be very surprised if at least part of the Maltese population had not converted to Islam during the two centuries of Arab colonization, at a time when expeditions leaving Tunisia engaged in proselytization. This is, of course, before Al-Himyari. Because Odizio spoke specifically about the issue of whether the Maltese had become Islamized when Malta fell under the Arabs. Like for other Piedmois, for Ropa, this brand of Mediterranean identity as synthesis was an alternative, all-encompassing identity that allowed him to negotiate his triple identities, Gozitan Maltese, Algerian, and French. Ropa's writings about Malta, the Maltese language and Maltese culture in general, have been widely interpreted by Lawrence Attard, Oliver Frigeri, Henry Frendo, and Roderick Bovington, and all, as unassailable evidence of his Maltese patriotism. But a reading of Andrea Smith's observations about a visit to Malta by Piedmois of Maltese descent suggests that there might also be something else happening to Laurent Ropa. When he writes about Malta, he is talking about a country that he has no first-hand experience of at all. He left the Maltese Islands with his family when he was two, as we said, and never returned. Despite his idealization of all things Maltese, all he could really write about with any degree of authority was the experience of his own family in the village of Alelik, close to Bonn, where they settled, and of the community they lived in. By the age of 23 or thereabouts, he had left Algeria as a conscript in the French army, and then moved to France. It seems to me that writing about Malta, its language, history, and culture was a way of returning, or rather reaching out to a lost, idealized home, a shadow of which existed in the relatively large Maltese settler communities in Egypt and North Africa. In his memory, the second home in French Algeria represents a mix between a lost Maltese home with its language and the culture at one end, and his third home in France at the other end. It can't have been an easy mix, because the hardships of agricultural life and unforgiving ethnic hierarchies in colonized Algeria, with the Maltese at the bottom of the European heap, at the bottom, must have been veritable forces to be reckoned with. What unites these three homes in Ropa's mind, these three neighboring identities, is, in my opinion, the all-encompassing Mediterranean in a continuum with its idealized, with his idealized Malta. Like his virtual Malta, Ropa's Mediterranean is an imaginary. It is a maison de la culture, perhaps, like the one Camus inaugurated in 1937. A Mediterranean culture in the process of being constructed. A work in progress, trying to work its way into people's lives and aspirations. But by the late 1930s, when Ropa, inebriated by the works of these Mediterranean visionaries like Odizio and Randau, writes about the process of or path towards a Mediterranean synthesis, he has already been in France for almost a quarter of a century, keeping in touch with the Maltese in Malta, Egypt, and North Africa by post. When the École d'Algérie is at the height of its activity, Ropa is not there. There is a lapse in time and space. All he can do is report. Imagine. My final paragraph. The sense that Odizio's Mediterranean is as much an empirical reality as a vision, an imaginary, comes across forcefully in his work, which had this great influence on Ropa. Despite the resurgence by temporal and even spiritual leaders of what he calls the most demented ambitions of Mediterranean imperialism, his peaceful patriotism continues to hear harmony. A Mediterranean in the making that is founded on a community of ideas. He sees this exemplary Mediterranean as a model offered to the whole world, to all the other families of human beings, to promote the vastest of groupings. He acknowledges that his is a utopia, but the utopia as today is the oxygen of the future. Odizio believes in the future of the Mediterranean because he believes in its youth, in its genius, which he sees as an eternal value, eternally creative. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Adrian, for a truly inspiring and highly differentiated talk. I think you gave us a lot to think about, and you told us a lot, not only about the Mediterranean, but also about the concept of utopia itself. I'm sure there will be many questions.
Let me just add that in the context of the present situation in the world, and I'm not only referring to Trump, but I'm also referring to many other situations, including, you know, situations that one finds in the Philippines with Duterte, you know, asking his followers to kill people indiscriminately. I think it's interesting to point out that Camus, in his speech, talks passionately against nationalism, passionately. Because he considers nationalism to be the sign of decadence, by the way.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Adrian, for a very inspiring talk. I would like to point out a few things. As you know, my interest in Albert Camus is not a passing fancy. And that is why I felt that I have had to intervene when I hear Kateb Yassin repeating things which have been proved to be false. Camus was never a racist. When you mention the lack of Muslims or Arabs in his major works, why not? That is something which anyone can vouch to because they are there. But Camus is also the person who gave us Chronique Algérienne, Actuel Trois, where we have there, in a nutshell, I would say, because he did far more, what he went through in order to push the Algerian cause. And the Algerian cause was not just for the Pieds-Noirs, was for those who lived in Kabylia, was for those who were suffering famine, those who were being promised so many things before the Second World War, but were never given their independence. It's true, Camus did not see independence the way that we know it. Why? Because he said it in the Chronique Algérienne. His idea of Algeria was that of the capital of a French Commonwealth. So he had big ambitions for Algeria. It is true that that his ideas were also being used by the extreme right, because the Action Française is Maurras, Charles Maurras' baby, so to speak. And that is the extreme right. But even when it comes to speaking about Romanity, we have to understand that he was writing in 1937. And, you know, Mussolini was already in power. Mussolini had already entered Ethiopia.
He refers
and,
to that.
He's taking a position against extremists. But then at the same time, in the speech, which I have translated into Maltese, and it will soon be published, all of it, this Maison de Culture speech, he says that even there you can see a difference between the way Italians express their extremism and the way Germans express their extremism. You know, there is a particular sentence in which he says the German would give you Heil Hitler in order to. But even when it comes to the reference to, you know, Russia, he was so sharp, although the Maison de la Culture was being subsidized by the Communist Party, not to say anything that would make his audience think that what's going on in Russia is ideal. And many other things which you have to read. Yes, I agree with you. Odysseus, Gabriel Odysseus influenced him. True. And that is also a way of saying that he had an ideal which might be considered akin to this utopia. But later on, not much later on, Camus spoke about utopia. And his ideas of the utopia after the experiences of the Second World War was, I have to quote, he writes in Ni Victime, Ni Bourreau, that this our utopia can only be relative, and I quote. I will not keep you much because there is a lot to say, but definitely I need to quote this. Because remember,
I think
he brings out the idea of a revolution, which is different from a rebellion. You know, it's there.
There is definitely a lot to say about Albert Camus and his positions. I think it might be interesting to point out that most of the people in the École d'Alger, the people we've been mentioning, basically left Algeria when things started getting rough. And I think you would imagine why. Because very often they were the targets of the people of Algeria who were fighting, dying to reclaim their land. But there's also the interesting case of Jean Sénac, who basically really sides with the Algerians in this case, and joins the Algerian forces, and he is completely in favor of the Algerians. You referred to what was happening, well, I refer to what was happening in Spain and also to the Germans. Matveyevich doesn't quite agree with him about this idea that the Mediterranean shapes the fascism that comes into it. He doesn't quite agree with this. He thinks that Camus is being is being incorrect when he says that. But at the same time, I find it very unusual that Camus, you know, attacks English colonialism. He attacks Italian colonialism and has nothing to say about French colonialism.
Because he was seeing the other side of how you can move away from colonialism. Because I mean, it's written.
He doesn't
here,
want
right?
to move away from colonialism. He wants Algeria to remain French,
but
basically.
It's written. He wrote it and he says black on white, La Nouvelle Algérie. In this essay, particular essay, he tells us exactly that things have to evolve. You cannot have colonialism anymore. You have to move away from it. And even when it came to Algeria, when the extreme right, you could say, started taking Arab lives and so on, when Camus asked for a truce, the ones who actually supported him, that is, supported him in a practical way, right, who guaranteed that he would not be killed, you mentioned that they were throwing tomatoes and stuff, and it was the FLN, Le Front National de la Libération. So there again, you have to agree that in the circumstances, you have a Camus who was proactive. He could not speak of a utopia simply because this is what we would like. We all like to have peace, understanding, and so on. But in the circumstances of the Second World War, extremism, Camus wrote about the...
If we will start talking we need more than an hour.
Adrian, I appreciate because you've showed that he's still pertinent today.
Absolutely.
Right? His ideas are there, but we cannot accept that he was a racist or that for some silly reason he gave up on his many Arab friends. Behind the scenes, he saved many lives, Albert Camus. Right? Thank you.
Let me just add that, again, I insist that my paper was not a definite judgment of the work
speech.
Or life of Albert Camus, even because I'm not an expert like Professor Aquilina is of Camus. That was not my object, of
but,
course.
I will be publishing so that your ideas can be confirmed.
We can read up. Yes, yeah. Thanks. There are more questions.
Is that now?
I'm just wondering. I don't think.
Yeah.
I might be putting you on the spot, but I wonder if you wouldn't mind commenting a little bit about the last comment you made, which was related to nationalism. Where you said your idea was that Camus, in fact, wanted to move away from the idea of nationalism. Is that related to the sense of utopia then? In the Mediterranean
well, actually,
that you were referring to?
Actually, Camus' discourse, the fact that Camus did not like nationalism was directly related to the fact that he saw the French nationalists as using nationalism in very negative ways. He saw Italian nationalists in the form of fascism, Mussolini. He mentions Mussolini directly in his speech, using nationalism in very negative ways, in very egoistic ways. So as a true left intellectual, he saw internationalism as the, the real alternative to the many ills brought by nationalism. So I personally would relate it to his leftist ideology, and to the fact that he saw peoples of different cultures working together rather than competing against each other or fighting against each other as a great ideal in his life, all
so
his life.
Almost the geography of the Mediterranean helps to sort of crystallize that, is that?
Yes, and this is why he sees, yeah, this is why he and Odysseo see the Mediterranean in a way as a microcosm of the world, of a possible world, of a different world. Thank you, Sarah.
I've got some points. I'll try to be quick as much as possible, I'm sorry. So the first one, I think, linking Camus with Utopia. I don't want, of course, to turn this discussion on to Camus. But first of all, Camus is a philosopher. Using literature, he's not a literature writer using philosophy, that's first of all. And I do consider Yassin's remarks as being racist, really, not Camus. Comparing Camus with Faulkner, and Faulkner was not a pied noir. I mean, the situation is completely different. I mean, comparing with Faulkner. The second point, I'm trying to be quick as much as possible. The second point is his Alger mother situation. Come on, I mean, we know Camus, at least basically, that he's attacking the fight, the Sisyphean fight against abstract ideals. This happened even in his conflict with Sartre. When Sartre told him, look, we have to fight for mankind, capital M, mankind. He said, no, I'm going to fight for my grandmother in Alger. Mm. That's what he's meaning. I'm not interested in Algeria as an abstract entity. I'm much more interested in my grandmother. So we have to fight for our neighbor against the utopic idea of ideal, come on, and killing and creating concentration camps in names of heaven on earth.
Exactly. This is what his speech is very much about. Absolutely.
This is the beauty.
Absolutely.
Of and another thing is something which really interested me, Adrian, and thanks for the rope, which a thing which I was completely unaware of. That's the third point, and it makes interesting reading. In fact, I consider myself then, now, after listening to your talk, as a ropeist, as regards the Mediterranean situation. What is also interesting is...
I tried to bring out the contradictions of Ropa, because I think one of the ways in which you can do somebody a lot of injustice is to be facile or simplistic or one-sided about that figure. Yeah. I think that's the greatest disservice you can do to someone.
I was completely unaware of his... his theory on Mediterranean. And it's quite, although there is a sort of centrist patriotism in it. But thinking deeply, I mean, yes, the Maltese nation has these components of being Mediterranean per se, even genetically, really. So another point which I think is of interest is, I mean, counterposing, create a counterpoint between whether there's a Roman legacy or Greco legacy, I think is a bit dangerous. I think in the Mediterranean we have a Roman legacy, nobody can refute this, as much as we have Greek and Mesopotamian and Egyptian. So I think this is very important. But what I really recall when I was listening to your part concerning this Greco or Roman is, don't forget that, I mean, German theoreticians, German Nazis, Nazi theoreticians, really equated German intellectual genetics to the Greeks, not to the Romans. It was fascism equating the Mediterranean with fascism, whereas Nazi philosophers, including Heidegger, found the Greek culture, Greek civilization, and Heidegger even went further, trying to find development, linguistic developments between the Greek, ancient Greek language and the German language. And here, of course, 1937 is a very dangerous year. Mm. It's quite interesting to see that Camus is sort of giving another yet alternative to this Nazi fascist attitude towards the Mediterranean. Mm. Okay? The last thing is a utopia, a concrete utopia, was, I mean, practically established, but it was aborted due to certain grotesque reasons, as it was called the Mediterranean Academy, where you had an expansive group of artists, including Hindemith, including Ozenfant, a lot. It was quite an interesting thing seeing Mendelssohn and Wiedewald, Ozenfant, and Marcello Piacentini, Mussolini's architect, as part of this group. And they established their commune, their utopian commune, in Nice. well, I don't want to continue, I mean, explain, but a sort of practical side of this Mediterranean utopia was attempted just towards 1937 also.
I think this might be what Ropa is referring to in one of his articles in Melita, when he talks about this meeting of Les Amitiés Méditerranéennes in Nice.
In Nice.
So he might be referring to this. He might be.
Part of it, it was, it
I would have to research
down,
this further.
On the eve of the launch, and Ozzy Enfant, who was one of the main founders, was a very superstitious artist, and he said, look, this is a bad moment, we have to stop.
Could I also say one last thing? I mean, you know, in this speech, well, Camus himself also is showing his idealism by saying things which were not true. For example, when he refers to Shmuel Xenophon, who was also a warrior, you know, returning back to Greece, he speaks of his soldiers seeing the sea and, you know, dancing and the lot. They did not dance, it's not true. And that sea was not the Mediterranean Sea. The sea that they saw from uphill was the Black Sea. But Camus, you know, in his ideal in 1937 to show what the Mediterranean could mean, made mistakes too. We're not here to justify everything that Camus wrote or said. And speaking about, you know, Ropa, if I understood you correctly, he said he was cut off from Malta. I can assure you that
I didn't
he wrote
say that.
Letters.
No, I didn't say
no,
that.
No, I know it, but you, I mean, it did not come out that his links with Malta were still
He corresponded continuously.
Continuously with his
not
brothers.
Only with his brothers. Here at the university, in the rare book section, in the archive section, we have some of his correspondence with many Maltese figures, like Nino Cremon and many others.
But his brother, who was a Dominican, Father Rapa, had a whole collection of letters. It would be nice if we could ask the Dominicans if they kept them, because it's really a treasure trove. They could be found. Thank you.
I think there is still, I think they're taking a lead from what Professor Aquilina is saying. I would say that there is still a lot of work to be done on Ropa. A lot of work, despite what has been published.
Thanks, Adrian. I really, really enjoyed that. Just two questions, really. On the question of Greek and Latin origins, I was wondering how emphatic Camus is, and especially in terms of emphasizing that there was something before the Roman Empire. And I'm asking because even in areas that were strongly influenced by Greek culture before the Roman Empire, like I'm thinking especially of Calabria, for example, you had authors throughout, but especially a whole reemergence in the 1500s and 1600s of authors that were reclaiming their the Greek origins, the cultural origins, precisely to show that there was something before the Roman Empire that had already connected the very idea of, in other words, the very idea of Mania Grecia before the sort of the whole presumed Pax Romana, etc. Mm. But the main question I wanted to ask was, to what extent do you see this development in the 20th century, really, but even a bit before in the 19th century, of Mediterranean utopias as an attempt to reclaim a place for the Mediterranean in the world? Because especially in previous, sort of the previous generation of utopias in the previous centuries, which someone like Ricoeur dismisses because he misreads mainly, the very idea of a utopia, even though it was written by authors who were Mediterranean or located in the Mediterranean, was always looking at extending west and east, especially after, of course, the contacts with the Americas and the East. What they were doing actually was minimizing the role of the Mediterranean, and consciously so, as a result of the extension. So I was just wondering whether you see an attempt in the 1800s and early 1900s of somehow reclaiming even a bit of a geopolitics of the Mediterranean, but under a utopian under sort of the utopian theme.
Mm. Neil Foxley, who writes this extraordinary book, contextualizing in many different ways Camus' speech, Camus' lecture, talks about how he sees the origins of the Saint-Simonian utopia, and eventually its development into a Mediterraneanist utopia in the 30s. He sees the origins of that in the expedition led by Napoleon in Egypt at the beginning of the 19th century. Because that expedition was a military expedition, it was a colonial expedition, but also was a scientific expedition, and an expedition which was meant to rediscover Egypt. But the Saint-Simonians were also very interested in India. Mm-hmm. So, I think the short answer would be that this discovery, this creation actually, this construction of a Mediterranean space, human cultural space, has its roots in French colonialism or imperialism. In this ambition of the French to, in the minds of certain French colonialists, to recreate the Roman Empire, because they were the legitimate heirs of the Roman Empire. And this is why Odizio and Camus, but Odizio does it, you know, practically in a whole book. He attacks this project, this Latinist, Romanist, whatever you want to call it, project, because he sees it as essentially a project which has the ambitions of imperialism. But on the other hand, the Saint-Simonians also had this very practical side. And they were entrepreneurs, they were engineers, they were businessmen, they were intellectuals, they were scientists. They were also in a way artists, but less so. So I would say, yes, they saw in the Mediterranean, quite frankly, an opportunity. An opportunity which had its origins in, you know, the expansion of the French of French power in the Mediterranean from Egypt towards France.
Maritime
mainly. But of course not maritime in the case of Algeria.
No,
very concrete.
But
at the same time, sort of, there was this very pragmatic side to it. There was this very business side to it. Very, very clearly business side to it. But also on another plane, this lofty side to it. And even Neil Foxley, who explores these many dimensions, also, of course, the colonialist dimension, he does not downplay the ideals that Camus and the École d'Alger in general put forward. One last comment, which perhaps partly answers your question, Jean-Paul, is that in this attack on Latinity and on the, you know, the militaristic Roman Empire, etc. It's downplayed a lot, the Roman Empire. In reality, there is, you know, a feud with their adversaries on the side of the staunch French colonialists, because the French colonialists saw they used the idea that France is an heir of the Roman Empire to justify, to legitimize their occupation, their colonization of Algeria. So the École d'Alger and people like Camus and Odizio attacked that position, which was basically, you know, it was, you know, in a way, don't get me wrong, but sort of petty politics, in a way.
Same thing you find in Calabria, Naples to some extent, with regards to Rome. It's the same dynamic. Thanks.
Thanks, Adrian. A very, very rich talk. A few remarks, if I may, and then a question. I'd like to echo Giuseppe's, in a sense, I guess, a sense of puzzlement about the comparison between Faulkner and Camus. It's it raises lots of issues about the practice and conceptualization of how comparative literature might
comparatism.
Work. I mean, there are various things that emerge as oddities there. But I think we can also accept it as a provocation that's strategic.
Absolutely.
In terms of what's happening there.
And that's why I think it works well in the talk.
Yes, and then it becomes readable in that sense, an exercise in that sense. And there's also a very interesting frame that Derrida talks about, within which all of this can be placed, which, you know, he refers to it in his book, The Other Heading, which is almost a critique of French colonialist or post-colonialist thinking, in which he refers cuttingly. It's a devastating comment. It's not a comment that's meant in any spirit of praise. What he refers to as the French genius for specializing in the universal, which is a really, 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 really devastating comment that just captures, I think, where he's heading in that book with the critique of a certain kind of French sentiment with this, that Derrida actually reads sympathetically, because he also honors what is, in the end, a great tradition, right? He's also speaking about Paul Valéry's contribution in that work. But what interests me in this, my question concerns this point, and I'm curious about how you view this as a scholar working in history, so to speak, of Mediterraneanism and so on, is whether you see all of this as expressing a kind of high modernist sensibility, a modernist or high modernist sensibility about how we construct the Mediterranean. Because what I find striking in what you're chronicling here is all of this is unthinkable in contemporary times, right? There is an idealism at work here, however we might decide to critique certain or deconstruct certain aspects of it. I guess there is an idealism or a spirit of idealism, a spirit of generosity even, that we have to honor, that we no longer have, because these are much more cynical times, right? Both in terms of the postmodernist sensibility or the post-postmodernist sensibility of thinking about how the Mediterranean is being constructed within a broader global politics. I don't think we could think in this way anymore. What Ropin and Valéry and
Brodel,
none of that is constructible now. And it's almost like we can be nostalgic or mourn a certain kind of scholarly sensibility that is now, in a sense, gone forever. I wonder whether you think that is fair, or whether you think there is something to salvage from that earlier kind of idealism and generosity and scholarly spirit. For example, this thing about the counter-Latinity. Right now, I'm interested in the theater of scholarly desires in all this, and why certain scholars are drawn towards the counter-Latinist impulse. For example, Michael Smith writes an absolutely beautiful book called The First Poets, seeking to trace the impulse for what we might think of as the poetic in Greek culture and so on. But it's clear that in some respects, that might have us insist on the literal-mindedness of historical accuracy. That is all wrong, right? But it's interesting to see that happen. But anyway, my main question is, because otherwise I'll start to ramble, my main question is, do you see, from our current standpoint, where we have become much more cynical, I guess, about discourses like this, and much more knowing as well. Do you see anything that we might want to salvage, even with our impulses for critique, for and counter-critique?
That's a difficult question, I would say. I can think of two quick reactions. One is from Matveyevich. The fact that Matveyevich, writing in the late 70s, manages to basically create this great phenomenon, this cult book with his Mediterranean cultural landscape. Whether this would be possible today, you know? Well, I think it would be. Mm. I think people want an alternative to the cynicism of... I think people want an alternative to the cynicism that we live in, even in a way. Exactly. That's my first point. Matveyevich says that the Mediterranean, well, basically translating, the Mediterranean is a choice, he says. In other words, absolutely utopian. The Mediterranean is a choice. To be Mediterranean is a choice. In other words, it has very little to do with empirical studies, as they tried to do in the Medlink report of 2006, you know, trying to literally create the Mediterranean with statistics and all of that. Or as Brodel tried to do by seeing a chain of mountains, you know, somehow locking in the shores of the Mediterranean into one region. He talks about a conviction, about a belief, about a utopia. And I think this is the moment, more than ever, to have such a utopia. On the other hand, I keep thinking of Michael Hertzfeld and his practical Mediterraneanism. Basically, Hertzfeld was this, you know, very insightful anthropologist, American anthropologist, working in the Mediterranean also. He talks about how the fact that the Mediterranean as a construct is a cultural construct, it's an imaginary, doesn't mean that it does not exist. Because for us, it exists. It exists in our imaginary. In the same way that Europe exists. Well, it's not the same thing. I don't want to do the the camel Faulkner thing, but but in the same way that sort of, theoretically speaking, you can construct a Europe or a United States, if anything, you can also construct a Mediterranean. And if you construct that Mediterranean, it exists. It has existed for at least 200 years. It has morphed, I suppose. But it exists, and I think there are many groups at grassroots level who, you know, in southern Italy and France and Tunisia and Algeria and Morocco that work together, who are, you know, these people are inspired by these ideals. And for them, the Mediterranean, this kind of fraternal Mediterranean is possible.
At least you salvage.
Is possible. It's a, you know, a continuous work in progress. I don't think I've answered your question, but it's a very difficult question.
Interesting.
I think what came out for me beautifully in your talk and in this whole discussion is this recurring tension between a universalism, if we may call it that, a utopian universalism, and a cultural specificity. And one of the definitions of the Mediterranean you elaborated to me sounded like a definition of the ideal of culture as such, this place of meeting, of mixing, of exchanging, this sea that brings people together. It could be an image of culture as we would like to imagine it. Of course, then you brought out, and the discussion brought out, that this could be seen as a Eurocentric or a Mediterranean-centric or an imperialist view. I wonder if you want to say a bit more about this tension between universalism and this universalism again becoming a kind of cultural hegemonialism, if you like.
The projects, the more recent projects of Mediterranean unity, basically failed. The Barcelona, again, I'm not sure I'm answering your question, Kathrin, but the Barcelona process was a big failure. And we're not even talking about the Union pour la Méditerranée which Sarkozy proposed, which was practically stillborn. I think the big problem with this discourse about the Mediterranean and Mediterraneanism is the fact that it is basically a discourse which you will hear mainly from Europeans. So if you want to dig, you will find some intellectuals or academics or activists at grassroots level working in Africa, north of Africa, or in the Near East, who will make reference to the Mediterranean. But unlike somebody like Mohamed Salah Homri, I'm not convinced that this imaginary is shared by activists, writers, intellectuals, of course, definitely not even less so perhaps common people in North Africa and the Near East. Mohamed Salah Homri, who's a colleague who teaches at Oxford, at St. John's, was telling me that when there was the Tunisian Revolution, they created a charter, which was an extraordinary document. These grassroots organizations wrote a charter together. And they made one mention of the Mediterranean. They referred to the Mediterranean when they were talking about the different identities of the Tunisians. They talked about the Tunisians as, you know, people of Tunisia, as Arabs, as Muslims, also as Mediterraneans. That's the only reference. I'm not sure that would be possible, again, because of the history, in Algeria. The Algerians were one of those people who really snubbed the Union pour la Méditerranée because of the whole baggage, you know, that comes with such ideas, which they see as very Eurocentric.
It almost means that the idea of the Mediterranean is itself a colonizing dynamic.
That's what really worries me. that's the bottom of the bottom. Yeah, that's.
That's really unfair. I'm sorry.
Tell me.
It's a bit unfair to deal with any concept which another, let's say, culture rejects or is not allowed as being imperialist. I mean, I do find it, I mean, it's true, but what Ivan and Adrian is saying, it's true. The Mediterranean seems to have a very, very, let's call it, generally speaking, European...
Eurocentric. Mm-hmm.
But to automatically, let's say, define it as imperialist, I do find it a bit strange.
The problem is to unload the baggage which comes with it. That's the problem.
Yeah.
It's a very big problem.
You reminded me of one thing. I mean, I don't want to sound a bit cynical, although I am, but I mean, racism works both ways. That's why I'm a bit angry at Yassin, really.
That's
because,
fair.
I mean, racism works both ways. It's a bit... Because I am a staunch believer of
Mediterranean,
really.
Believe me, so am I. I wouldn't be here if I weren't. But I think one has to be very critical.
In Algeria in the 50s, when you speak of Fathat Abbas, for example, right?
he was pro-French. Completely pro-French. He really idealized French culture to the extent that if he was helped, and this is the irony of it all, he could have really made history and changed the course of history in Algeria. But he was not backed by the intellectuals and the French people themselves in Algeria, because of all the, you know what happens in, you know, politics, there are interests, see? Had the nucleus of Arab leaders who were convinced that there is a future for the Mediterranean, if they had their way, things would have been very different.
Thank you. I mean, I think this loaded term of imperialism shows one thing that you also mentioned. It's a question of power hierarchies, and even the question of racism is, does it come from an oppressed group or does it come from those in power? I think what came out beautifully is this kind of dialectic that we have to be critical whilst we are being utopian. We can keep up this imaginary, but we must not forget the critique. And I think if a Mediterranean unity was to be thought about now, it would have very practical material consequences for the border politics of the EU. And in that way, maybe there are political interests for keeping quite silent this kind of connection.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Adrian.
I want to say something. My concluding comment is, at one point I'm looking for it, but
I felt a space, you know.
Which one must?
And you want spaces to be invaded, I suppose. Camus says something really beautiful at one point. He talks about how people must be in harmony within the space in which they live, and that every and therefore sort of what is created in the Mediterranean or in Mediterranean culture cannot be transported to other places, because in every place one needs to create a harmony which is, you know, which is rooted in that space, in that territory, in those cultures, in that history, in that specific reality. And I think that's, to me, that sounds very liberating. And
so thanks again also for the discussion and the highly interesting talk.